question, the, I have been saying that, okay, either it could be a 120 degree direction or it could be a 6 step. Harmonic spectrum is the same. Now, if I have to reduce the THD, what do I do? Now, I am not going to, I will just show you a result. Based on that, we will make conclusions and we will go ahead. If you are not convinced, I will show you. See, there are large number of pulses here, and this is the current waveform, load current waveform. It is almost a sinusoid, almost a sinusoid, almost a sinusoid. See here, there are large number of pulses in one cycle, and this is the current waveform, almost a sinusoid. I am assuming that load is inductive, load is inductive. So, if I have, if I turn on the device and allow the device to conduct for 180 degrees, there is a problem. Harmonics is plus or 6 and plus or minus 1. Instead, if I have a large number of pulses in one cycle, in half a cycle, current waveform is going to be sinusoidal. Okay? How are we getting the sinusoidal? I will explain to you with the equivalent circuit. Okay? So, one conclusion that we can make is, if there are large number of pulses, my current waveform is almost a sinusoid. So therefore, the question immediately arises, how to have this so many number of pulses? Who will tell us how to, when to turn on and when to turn it off? For that, I need to have a strategy, what is known as a pulse width modulation strategy. Okay? There are various pulse width modulation strategies. Before doing that, I will explain to you using the equivalent circuit, how we can get a sinusoidal current from this pulse supply. Okay? One way is to write the Fourier series using the Bessel's function and get the harmonics series or the harmonic spectrum of this, which is mathematically involved. Second is from the equivalent circuit. I will just take the second method, which is relatively simple. See, I have a large number of pulses, and these pulses are applied to an RL circuit. Load is inductive, highly inductive. Okay? What will happen? A DC is applied for a very short time. So definitely current will increase. Okay? Current starts increasing. Whereas in a 180 degree, we turned on the switch and we allowed it to conduct for 180 degrees. So current increase and try to saturate. Whereas here I am applying it for a very short duration. The circuit is inductive, RL circuit, okay, and we know that initial portion of this current waveform is linear. This is almost linear. So this waveform or this current rise, I can approximate it to a straight line. See, after some time, I am turning it off, applying a zero voltage. So what will happen when I apply a zero voltage here to an RL circuit? Current will decay. Okay, current will slowly decay. Again, I will turn it on. Okay? Now, the width of the second pulse is slightly higher than the width of the first pulse. So, what will happen? Current will again increase. Okay? After some time, I will decrease. I will turn it off. So, similarly, if there are large number of pulses, I have an approximately a sine wave. So that is nothing but the pulse width modulation strategy. The technique is very simple. I have large number of pulses, and because of the load being inductive, I can have almost a sinusoid, almost a sinusoid. So what I can infer? What I can infer? If I apply sinusoid voltage to this RL load, current is sinusoidal, maybe lagging by some angle theta. Power factor angle at steady state. If I apply a pulsed waveform, my current is still a sinusoid. That's what I showed you, and that's what I can infer from this diagram as well. There are large number of pulses, yet the current waveform is sinusoid. Okay? What can I conclude? I'll repeat my question. I have an RL load, apply a sinusoidal voltage, current is a sinusoid. that I can all of us know. Now instead of applying a sinusoid, I'll apply a square wave. In the sense, these are all square waves. There are large number of pulses in one cycle. Large number of pulses in one cycle. Current waveform is a sinusoid. What can I infer? One simple inference is current waveform drawn by this load is independent of the excitation. Okay. I'll repeat. Current drawn is sinusoid. For load is being the load is when the load is RL applied voltage is sinusoidal, current is also sinusoid. Current drawn is sinusoid when the voltage applied is non-sinusoidal. So what conclusion can I make? The conclusion is that looks like this pulsed waveform has a fundamental component, has a fundamental component of 40 hertz, okay, which is sinusoid, and has a very high harmonic, other harmonic components, and for those harmonic components, my RL circuit does not respond. Or for those high frequency harmonic content, impedance offered by the RL circuit is so high, therefore the circuit behaves as if it is an open circuit. I will repeat, my conclusion is that this stepped waveform or this pulse waveform has a fundamental component which is a sinusoid, and that forces the sinusoidal current. In addition, it has high frequency components. Those high frequency components are not able to supply any current because the impedance offered by this inductive load is high. It makes sense. As the frequency increases, impedance offered by the inductance also increases. So what do I need to do is, now the THD of this waveform is definitely is very less compared to this waveform, the so called 6-step waveform. So I cannot allow the 180 degree conduction, so therefore I need to a large number of pulses. Now who will tell me how to, oh, when to turn on the device and when to turn it off? That I told you a PWM strategy. There are various number of PWM strategies. I will try to do only two of them. One is a sinusoidal PWM technique, and second is what is known as a space vector PWM technique. Sinusoidal PWM technique, all of us know. What I need to do is, there is a sinusoidal modulating function, a sinusoidal modulating waveform, a sinusoidal modulating waveform, and there is a high frequency carrier waveform. They are compared. Intersection of these two will determine the turning instant of S1 and S4. So in a three phase inverter, there are three sinusoids which are displaced by 120 degrees, and there is only one carrier. Okay. They are compared, and intersection will determine the switching instant. Now, if I want to have a 50 hertz supply, the frequency of the modulating wave is 50 hertz. Okay. But then how will I determine the magnitude of this triangular waveform or this carrier? By the way, the magnitude of the carrier is fixed, and frequency is also fixed. How do I select the frequency? At every instant, every intersection, S1 is turned on and S4 is turned off, and vice versa. Okay. At any given time, one switch is on. So if S1 is turned on, S4 is turned off. So depending upon the power level and depending upon the switches, I need to select the frequency of this triangular waveform. Lower the power, and if I have faster devices, higher could be the switching frequency. Say for example, if I have a 5 kVA inverter, triangular frequency could be of the order of 10 kilohertz or so. Okay. Whereas if I have a 1 megawatt inverter, triangular frequency could be of the order of 550 hertz, not more than 11 times. That also again at a higher upper limit. So depending upon the power, the switching frequency, the switching frequency or the carrier frequency is changed. And if I see the harmonic spectrum, they look like there is a fundamental component of 50 hertz, and the immediate dominant harmonic is approximately equal to frequency of the triangular wave minus the frequency of the sinusoidal waveform. I will repeat, the harmonic spectrum is fundamental component, okay, which is 50 hertz here, and the dominant harmonic is, or immediate dominant harmonic is, the frequency of the triangular wave minus 50 hertz, and next is frequency of the triangular wave plus 50 hertz. So at those two bands there is a predominant harmonic present. That is about sinusoidal PWM technique. Okay, next one I will do, which is a space vector PWM technique, which is very popular. If you are feeding power to the grid, generally space vector PWM technique is used. Okay, I'll cover what exactly the space vector PWM technique is. Relatively simple, very popular. I'll explain. If Vi is equal to Vm sin omega t, Vb is equal to sin Vc is equal to this, Vab is equal to, I can represent this three vectors in a two dimensional space. Okay, voltage space vector Vs by definition is given by this. Okay, I can substitute for Va, Vb, Vc, I get, and simplifying, I will get Vs 3 by 2 Vm sin omega t minus j omega t, the space vector having 3 by 2 Vm, and it rotates in space at omega radians per second. Okay, so if I know Vs and if I know the theta at any given time, I can get its d and q axis component, and if I can get d and q axis component, it is possible to get the value of Va, Vb, Vc. So that is what I am doing here, nothing, I am just resolving these three phase vectors along x axis and y axis. See here, Va, Bc, what is the x axis component of A, B and C? X axis component of Va is 1, Vb is cos 120, that is minus half, and Vc is cos 240, is again minus half. Vy is y axis component is 0. Okay, y axis component of sin 120 is root 3 by 2, sin 240 is minus root 3 by 2. Okay, so if I simplify, Vx is equal to 3 by 2 Va. Okay, and Vy is equal to root 3 by 2 Vb minus Vc, just matrix multiplication, quick. Now let us see, now all of us know that Va 0, Vb 0, Vc 0 could be plus Vdc by 2 or minus Vdc by 2. Okay, so and I can write using KVL, Va 0 is equal to Van plus Vno. Okay, Van is equal to, Van is equal to Va 0 minus Vno. Similarly, I write these three equations, I will add them up, Van plus Vbn plus Vcn is equal to 0, substitute them here, I will get Vno is equal to, given by this equation, I will add them, I will get 3no is equal to Va 0 plus Vb 0 plus Vc 0. So Vno is equal to 1/3 this. Now substitute this value of Vno in this equation, and in the equation, and we can write Van, Vbn and Vcn in matrix form, something like this. Van, Vbn, Vcn is equal to Va 0, Vb 0, Vc 0, 2 minus 1 minus 1 minus 1, 2 minus 1 minus 1 minus 1, 2. Go back and simplify, it is simple. don't get tri-stated, these are correct. If the, I told you there are 8 possible states of the inverter, 000 to 111, these are null states. VAN, VBN, VCN are 0. So if VAN, VBN, VCN are 0, what will happen to, what will happen to X and Y, VX and VY? VAN, VBN, VCN are 0, therefore VX and VY are 0. If V and VX and VY are 0 in the XY plane, magnitude of the space vector is 0. And tan inverse of VY by VX is the position of the space vector. That means I am at the origin. So for when all three switches are on and all three switches are off, magnitude of the space vector is 0 and we are at the origin. Now what about the remaining 6 vectors? What I will do is A phase, A first leg, upper is on and lower 2 are off. These are the phase voltages, sorry, the pole voltages. I can substitute VS0, VB0, VC0 in, please don't get confused, I know VS0, VB0, VC0, I will substitute here, I can get VAN, VBN, VCN, and if I know VAN, VBN, VCN, I can get X and Y, VX and VY, and if I can get VX and VY, I can get VS, okay. So this is the procedure, that is all. So for this 001, VS0 is VDC by 2, VB0 and VC0 are minus VDC by 2. So I got VS0, VB0, VC0, quickly I will write VAN, VBN, VCN and therefore VX and VY. So it so happens that VX is equal to VDC, VY is equal to 0. So the magnitude of the space vector is VS. And angle is 0 because Y component is 0, okay. So if 0, 0, 1 corresponds to magnitude VDC 1 and angle 0, that means I am along the X axis, along the X axis, 1, 1, 0 will be magnitude 1. Angle 180 degree because that is the complementary vector. I will repeat, if 0, 0, 1 corresponds to 1 at an angle 0, 1, 1, 0 will be 1 angle minus 180. Now second state I will take two devices on, A phase and B phase, C phase is lower is on. So this is the pole voltages, I know the pole voltages, from those pole voltages I can determine the phase voltages from that matrix and from these phase voltages I can get X component and Y component. X is half VDC and Y is root 3 by 2 VDC. So what is the magnitude? VX square plus VY square, square root is 1. Angle 60 degrees because tan inverse of Y by X, tan inverse of Y by X is 60 degrees. So the magnitude of the space vector is again 1 or VDC, similar to the previous case, previous two cases, but angle is 60 degrees, okay. So therefore for 0, 1, 1 magnitude is 1 at an angle 60 degrees, for 1, 0, 0 magnitude is 1. Angle will be, where will I be? Tell me. It is 60 plus or minus 180. Okay. So I will be in the third quadrant. Third quadrant. Okay, it's a complementary of this vector. Okay. So we have already found out the position of the space vector for 4 vectors, only 2 are remaining. And what are they? Here. For 110, it is VS at an angle 240. The last one is 010. B is on, A and C are off. Same procedure, I can get or we get magnitude 1, angle 120 degrees, vector is moved by 120 degrees, the complementary will be 300, angle 300. So, see here, these are the pole voltages for those 3 phase inverter, pole voltages for 3 phase inverter. This is A phase, B phase, C phase, okay. A is on, B is off, B is off, there is nothing but 0, 0, 1 vector. A is on, B is off, B is 0, C is 0, that is 0, 0, 1, magnitude is 1, angle 0, we are here. Next is A is on, B is on, C is off, A is on, B is on, C is off, the lower. I said magnitude is 1, angle is 60 degrees, we are here. The next vector is only B is on, A and C are off, in that sense lower switches are on. Magnitude is 120, so magnitude is 1, angle is 120. Now these 3 we determined the complementary, we can immediately draw. If it is 001, it is 110, 011, it is 100, 010, it is 101. So this is, so 6 active vectors, 6 active vectors occupy the vertices of an hexagon. These are the active states, these are the active states, and these are 2 are null states which are in the origin. So, 6 active vectors occupy 6 vertices of the hexagon. So, what we observe from V1 to V2, from one position to another position, we go by just by turning on or off one device. What did we do here? We turned on B phase. See, we were at the origin, all upper switches are off, 0, 0, 0. All upper switches are off, we are at the origin. Now, I'll turn on only phase A. See, somewhere we are here, at this point at pi by 3, I turn on phase A, magnitude is 1, angle 0. If I wait for 1/6 of a cycle, I will repeat, if I wait for 1/6 of a cycle and at the end of 1/6 of a cycle, if I turn on B phase also, the vector moves by 60 degrees to this place. See here, 0, 0, 1, and at this point B phase also turned on. We will we'll allow the vector to wait for 60 degrees in that place, or we'll allow the vector to wait, remain there for 1/6 of a cycle, turn off phase A, the upper switch, vector, when you do that, it goes, moves by another 60 degrees. See here, 0, 0, 1, phase A turned on, phase B turned on, phase A turned off, here phase C turned on, okay, phase B turned off, phase A turned on, phase C turned off, I mean upper switches are turned off, I am just talking about upper switches. So, what exactly are we doing? Okay. Every 1/6 of a cycle, we are changing the conduction state of one switch. And if I do that, I will move, or the space vector moves by 60 degrees. Space vector for every change in conduction state of switch moves by 60 degrees. And it completes one cycle in 6 steps. So, this is nothing but 6 step operation This is nothing but sixth step operation. Okay. The predominant harmonic is again fifth and seventh. But then we need to have a very low THD. Therefore, we have to eliminate the lower order harmonics. Okay. So therefore, we cannot remain idle for 1/6 of a cycle at one particular state. See, I will repeat, we have to reduce the THD. So therefore, we require large number of pulses. We cannot allow the space vector to remain idle for 1/6 of a cycle at one particular position. Okay. So now, how do we have pulse width modulation, or how do we have large number of pulses here? Because I can move from, see, the origin I came here by turning on or off only one switch. Immediately, if when I turn on another switch, I will go here, it moves by 60 degrees. Okay. From here to here by another 60 degrees, but I have only this choice, no other choice. But then with using these choices, I have to construct a smooth sinusoid. I cannot have 6 step operation. What do we do? What do we do? I want to have, we need to have a pure sinusoid. By the way, if I have pure sinusoids, okay, pure sinusoids, what is the trajectory? What is the space vector? How does the space vector look like? Or what is the locus of the space vector Vs? Here I have a hexagon, okay, because the line voltages or pole voltages are of 180 degree duration and they are square wave. Therefore, I get a hexagon, but then I want the output voltages to be sinusoidal. Now, if I get a sinusoid, if I have three phase sinusoid, what is the locus of the space vector? The locus of space vector is a circle. It rotates at a uniform velocity omega. Now, how to realize these three sinusoids? Okay, is a question that I am asking. You need to listen to me carefully for 10 minutes, that should be sufficient. Okay. See, here are observation, active vectors are pi radians apart. Okay. Describe a hexagon boundary, 6 active sector occupy 6 vertices of hexagon, 0 vectors at the origin. Okay. This what it is, modulation index. If the output voltages are pure sinusoids, I can write Vs is equal to m into e to the power j omega t. M is a modulation index. And output voltage of the inverter is proportional to M. Output voltage of the inverter is proportional to M, provided we keep the DC link voltage constant. I will repeat, output voltage of the inverter is proportional to the modulation index M, if I keep the DC link voltage constant. What is M in sinusoidal PWM technique? M in sinusoidal PWM technique is magnitude of the reference sinusoid or the magnitude of the modulating wave divided by the magnitude of the triangular wave. If I want to have a constant 230 volt 50 hertz supply, I need to keep the magnitude of the sine wave constant. Also, I need to keep the magnitude of the triangular wave constant. If I want to have a variable output voltage, I need to change M, or I need to change the magnitude of the modulating wave. We do not do anything to the magnitude of the carrier wave, it is maintained constant. Okay. So, M is output frequency, it is 50 hertz in radians per second, of course, locus is a circle. Okay. So, ideal trajectory of Vs should be a circle and should rotate at uniform angular velocity. Okay. should be achieved by a PWM process. So in other words, see what I'm saying, I may be saying is sine wave. How do I digitize this sine wave? Or if I digitize, how does it look like? There are large number of steps. Large number of steps. And so that is nothing but a digitizing the sine wave. See what happens? Suppose if I sample this waveform and I keep it, hold it for some time, what is known as the TS time. And if I observe it in oscilloscope, how does it look like? Waveform is sampled at a particular value, instantaneous value, and it is held constant for whatever the TS time. TS time is known as the sampling time. It looks something like this. So during TS reference vector, TS reference vector is assumed to remain stationary at that particular time, particular point. Okay. In other words, the vector is rotating at a uniform frequency or radians per second, and in the sampling time, that vector is supposed to remain constant. Okay. As time increases, the position of the vector changes. Okay. But in that particular time, sampling time, it remains stationary. Okay. If the vector is remained stationary at a particular point, at that particular point, I will find out what is the x axis value of that vector and what is the y axis value of that vector. See, for example, what I will do is, this is the trajectory of the output voltage waveform, which is a circle provided the voltage is a sinusoid. Okay. For TS time, TS is a sampling time, I will assume that this vector remains stationary, okay, at theta. After TS, this vector will rotate by another angle, delta theta. Delta theta. Okay. This is after time delta t, then again it will remain stationary for some time there. So if I know theta, and of course this is nothing but a modulation index itself, I can get the x axis component and I can get the y axis component. I can get Vx and Vy. So what will I do after knowing Vx and Vy? I will go back to the inverter. I will repeat, if I assume that now I have three phase sinusoids, those three phase sinusoids whose magnitude is proportional to m, they rotate at constant omega. At a particular time, I know theta, okay, and this vector is stationary for time Ts, what is known as the sampling time. So since I know theta and if I know the modulation index, I can get Vx and Vy. Okay. Now can I get this Vx and Vy by using the inverter switches? Okay. The question is, can I get Vx and Vy by using the inverter switches? That's all. Assume that we are in the sector 1, in the first 60 degrees, and the vector, I want the output voltage whose value is proportional to V star and is making an angle theta. I told you that I can resolve along x and y axis, Vx and Vy are thus their values. Now I have to get this Vx and Vy using this inverter switches. Okay. See here, when all the three switches are off, we are at the origin. The moment I turn on phase A, we moved here. This vector has only x axis component, there is no y axis component. Okay. So I will apply this vector for some seconds t1. Don't ask me what is the relationship between t1 and ts. After some time, after t1 seconds, I will apply v2. I will turn on b phase. Okay, the vector rotates by 60 degrees and this vector will be there for t2 seconds. See, when I apply v2, it has a x axis component and a y axis component. What is the x axis component? V2 cos 60, okay, and y axis component is v2 sin 60. So what is the total x axis component? The total x axis component here is, or the so called volt second, is v1 into t1, okay, similar, plus v2 into t2 into cos 60. It is a net x axis component of the volt second. Why volt second? I will tell you. What is the y axis component? It is 0. Y axis component of v2 is v2 into t2 into sin 60. Okay. So volt second balance is, what is volt second balance? Volt second balance is nothing but the flux. Volt second is nothing but the flux. Okay. So sigma x axis of RH is VDC into T1. Why VDC? It is V1. V1 is VDC is again V2 cos 60 into T2. Okay. Sigma x of LHS. What is sigma L of HHS? It is Vx itself. See here. Vs into Ts, because voltage vector Vs is supposed to remain there for Ts seconds, and x axis component is Vs into Ts into cos theta. Vs into Ts into cos theta is the x axis component. That should be equal to V1 T1 into cos 0, V2 into T2 into cos 60. That is the x axis component of these two vectors. Similarly, y axis component of the space vector is Vs into Ts into sin theta. That should be equal to V2 into T2 into cos, sorry, into sin 60. That's all. Simplify it, you will get a very simple expression, very simple expression, very simple expression. See, T1, T2 is, see, T2, T2 is given by Tc, Tc is nothing but Ts by 2. A is nothing but the modulation index. Sin 60 is known. Sin theta is the position of the space vector. Position of the space vector, sin theta. At some t, it was at this position. After some time, it moves by an angle delta theta. So I can get an expression for t2, time for which t2 is on. Sorry, time for which this vector is applied. Time for which this applied is t2. Time for which v1 is applied is t1. So expression for t1 and t2 are here. They are very simple expressions. Yeah, I will stop here.